He is the king of Madison Square Garden and a son of Sweden. Join Henrik Lundqvist and I as we tour his homeland, only on the Game 365. Hockey is a team sport, but there is one player whose performance has more impact than any other. He is the last line of defense, and while an off night for a goaltender will more often than not lead to a loss, a stellar performance can neutralize even the strongest of opponents.
Glove save by Lundqvist, and they're on their feet at the Garden.
There he is, the king.
Of course, with all this responsibility comes pressure. But luckily for the New York Rangers, their netminder can handle it all. Even though he has played his entire NHL career under the bright spotlight that Madison Square Garden brings, Henrik Lundqvist is the only goalie in the league's history to win at least 30 games in his first six seasons.
Looking, and a shot save! Tough save! Backstrom shoots! Great save by Lundqvist!
In front, save! What a save by Lundqvist!
A natural on Broadway, his career began an ocean away. I met up with Henrik in Gothenburg, Sweden, the city where he paved his path to National Hockey League stardom. So Hank, tell us about this city. You moved here at 16 years old.
16 years old, me and my brother moved from our parents down south up here to Gothenburg. And, you know, 3 years in school and then we turned pro. Played for Frölunda here in Gothenburg for me, 5 years on the pro team. And yeah, it was a great experience to play for that club and to be in this city. And I go back here every summer.
Was your dream to play professional hockey?
Yes. I think ever since I was 5, 6 years old, I think hockey's been my biggest dream. I wanted to play hockey professionally, and at first, you know, to play for the national team, playing in Gothenburg for Frölunda, but also to play in NHL. It's been a big dream, and, you know, first game, first time I put the Ranger jersey on, it was a very special moment in my life, in my career.
Getting back to the city, what does it mean to you for your development?
The youth program here in Gothenburg is one of the top in the country. That's why we picked to come here, but also Frölunda was our favorite club to play for.
That club is the Frölunda Indians of the Swedish Premier League, where Henrik and his twin brother Joel played alongside each other from 2001 to 2005. The next season, things changed. From 2006 through 2009, both played for different NHL squads, and the twins faced off against each other three times.
Feel good story. The other big personal story in this game is Henrik Lundqvist and Joel Lundqvist, twin brothers, playing against one another tonight.
Joel rejoined Frölunda 2 years ago, and now the rivalry will be rekindled. On September 30th, 2011, the Rangers will travel to Gothenburg to play the Indians in a preseason exhibition game. Here you are, you guys are gonna have an exhibition game in this city. What does that mean? To a kid that at 16 years old, it was some of your formative years?
It's gonna be very emotional, I think, because I experienced a lot of good years here in Gothenburg. Two championships, and also a lot of old friends play for Frölunda now, and my twin brother is playing here, so it's going to be like I said, a great experience, but also very emotional, I think, to be out there.
Okay, if there's a fight in that game, how do you hit your twin brother?
Well, I hit him a lot of times.
Did you?
No, not on the ice, but off the ice, so we'll see.
Henrik spends a good portion of the offseason in his former home, which means in addition to basking in the beauty of the city, he also needs to find time to train. He wanted to take me along to one of his workout sessions and even offered to drive. Needless to say, it was a proposal I couldn't refuse.
How do you get ready for the season when you're during the off season? What's a goalie do?
Well, first few weeks you just rest. You need to get away from the game a little bit and then clear your head. And then you start to get a little hungry again and start to feel the need of, you know, winning and get better as a player. But physically, I train. I'm in the gym. I play a lot of tennis. And then I start skating in late July or early August. Mm-hmm.
Now, for a goalie, when you talk about skating, you really, I'm assuming, are in goal.
I'm in goal, yeah. Yeah, once in a while you do some just fast skating just to get the heart beating a little faster. But when I say skate, most of the time you just, you have shooters on the ice. Mm-hmm. When you're off from the game for a few months or weeks, you lose the touch, you lose the timing. So coming back, I'm terrible. The first month, I'm just terrible on the ice. In goal. I always question myself in August, every year. I'm like, can I really do this? Or am I gonna come back in great shape to, not physically, but more, have the right touch on the ice and timing. That's always a big issue, but I know also deep inside I will get back there, but it just takes time. You need to spend a lot of hours out there every day.
Henrik Lundqvist and I continued our road trip to his training session. And as I admired the beautiful architecture of Gothenburg, I began to wonder how comfortable the Swedish star is with spending so much time away from his homeland.
When you're done playing, where do you think you're going to live?
I talked to my wife about it, and we love New York so much that, we could see ourselves living in New York after.
Full-time?
Full-time, yeah. I still go back during the summer to Sweden, but it's hard to say right now. So many things can happen in the next 10 years that you can't really predict, but we love it over there. But at the same time, we have a lot of friends back here, our family's here, and obviously that will be a deciding factor as well, if you want to be closer to them or not.
When Henrik comes home, he also rekindles a connection with one member of his hockey family. During the offseason, Lundqvist trains at his former team's practice facility. Some of the time, his regiment includes watching his former squad, and more particularly, his twin brother, Joel.
Started playing in kindergarten when we were like 4 or 5 skating, and started in a team when we were 9 years old. So it was the first practice. The coach asked all the guys if we had a goalie, and I knew he wanted to be in the net. So I just raised his hand and said he wanted to be in the net. So he has a lot to thank me for.
And when the Rangers goalie hits the ice, he practices against quality competition. Though Henrik only works with a handful of players, he competes against many of those who know him best, including former Swedish teammate and NHL star, Louis Eriksson. You guys practice here, and yet you play against each other during the season. What's it like to go out to try to score on him?
It's always fun to practice against him because he hated when you score on him, and it's always nice when you go home to, like, when you spend your time during the summers, he's always here, and it's always fun to have a goalie to shoot on, and he's a real good goalie too, so that's make it a little bit tougher for us to practice against him, but it's a good learning for us too.
After turning aside a bunch of shots, Henrik moved his workout to the gym, where he works hard to keep his body in peak condition. Hank, tell us about your workout here in the gym.
It's it's all different. Some days I try to do more legs and squats, you know, and then it's a little heavier, but today it was more body weight, you know, push-ups and for your abs and back. So a lot of core stuff.
All the sweating helps Henrik prepare to pull his weight on the ice. How heavy is the equipment you wear?
I would say 25 to 30 pounds. And after the game, it's usually 55.
Really?
With all the water and sweat.
What would you say you would lose as far as water weight?
Well, I drink some. I have it in my routine now to drink a lot, so I don't lose that much weight. But if I would cut down the drinking, I would definitely lose, you know, 5-6 pounds.
Here's a breakaway, Ovechkin! Save!
Lundqvist is among many international stars whose hard work and skill has contributed to a recent spike in the popularity of hockey in the United States. But has his newfound passion for the NHL made its way across the pond? Do they cover the NHL closely, the media here in Sweden?
Yeah, last few years, I think they picked it up more and more. And now, you know, you have more options. 10 years ago, when I was 13, 14, it was tougher to follow the NHL. First of all, the time difference is still tough because it's the middle of the night a lot of times. But reruns the next day, it's easier now to watch games and highlights. And but even the papers write, I think, a little bit more now.
Everybody that practices stays from Sweden. Is there national competition between you guys when you're playing in the NHL?
Well, I mean, it doesn't matter where you're from. It's, for me, it's game on when it's game time. The only difference is when I play against a Swede, a lot of times I know the guy. I play with him in the national team, or I know him from back home, that's the biggest difference. But when they drop the puck, it doesn't really matter if you're from Czech or Canada or US or Sweden. It's a big battle.
After an intense day of training, Henrik Lundqvist was ready to show me some of the finer parts of his home country. But before we hit the road, he recounted some of his fondest moments, forever on display in the hallway of his former team's practice facility.
This is the last two championships we won here in Gothenburg. This is 03, my first championship. Then 2 years later, we won that year as well.
How have you changed since these two pictures?
Well, my life have changed a lot. Of course, it changes you a little bit. Come to New York and deal with a little bit more pressure and experience a lot of things. You know, you have to grow up a little bit, hopefully.
In New York, there's, as you mentioned, a lot of things going on, a lot of more pressure in New York. How did you deal with it when you first were exposed to it?
When I came to New York, I knew it's a place where, you know, a lot of people expect a lot of you, and but at the same time, it's like if you work really hard and show good attitude, they can take that. You can't win all the time, but it felt like as long as I show up and do whatever I can and you know, be accountable for my actions, and good things will happen, hopefully.
In front, Bochensky, save! Rebound, save! Saint-Louis, saved by Lundqvist!
Lundqvist plays the fastest game in the world in a city that never sleeps, and you'd be hard-pressed to find anyone that believes he hasn't lived up to or performed above his expectations. I guess it comes as no surprise, then, Henrik also goes high-octane off the ice.
Now, growing up in Sweden, did you ever think you'd drive a Maserati?
I probably didn't know what a Maserati was, you know. I grew up in a small town and probably just had a lot of Volvos or Saab.
Are you a car lover? Since this is a beautiful car that handles well, it's got some speed.
Yeah, I love cars. I don't know much about cars. I just love the design. I love, you know, the speed and the sound. The sound is very important to me.
As far as being a spokesperson for companies, you'd be a natural in New York. Is it an active profession for hockey players?
To be spokesperson?
Yeah.
Tough question. I don't know. I have a few, you know, different companies that I work with, and I you know, you can say I'm a spokesperson. Some companies use me more. Some companies just, you know, I show up once in a while and shake hands. It's all different.
Many of Henrik's endorsement deals center on his interest, but some also take advantage of his sheer marketability. In addition to performing for the Rangers on the ice, Henrik also helps the team and others away from the rink. He is the club spokesman for the Garden of Dreams Foundation, and needless to say, his well-rounded life makes him attractive to advertisers. To get a behind-the-scenes look at Henrik as a pitchman, I tagged along on one of his recent promotional shoots.
Commercials for players. It's always been something that's been attractive to players in all sports. You seem to be a man who's been in demand. What does that mean to you as an athlete?
You know what? I like the part when you get an opportunity to meet, not the sports side, but more the media business, the TV, radio, commercial stuff. Like, it's very interesting to me to sit down with a group and go through different projects. And it's kind of fun to see how things develop and, yeah, just see a different side, another business, other types of people. And I like that.
Lights, camera, action. That's next on the Game 365.
Sounds off from Cap.
Leader, philanthropist, spokesman, king. He is already a man of many titles. But after watching Henrik Lundqvist at his commercial shoot, I was ready to add another to the list. Producer.
What, five different scenes in what?
2 hours.
2 hours? That's pretty fast. Took me probably 12 hours last time. So.
Tell us what you're doing here right now.
What we're doing is that we're shooting Henk for an online campaign that we're running. We will run. Henk has been starring the commercial that we have run with Head & Shoulders during the spring. And what we're doing is that we are making light of that commercial. So Henk is redoing the scenes, but in another way.
How involved is Henk in this commercial?
He has come back with ideas on the manuscript. He has himself also wanted to do something like this, so quite a lot, I would say.
First of all, one take, that's all we need.
This idea you came up with, Head & Shoulders embraced it. How'd you get them to embrace it?
Well, actually, we had a production company as well, coming with different ideas, and just have a little fun with it. I think it's important that you can show people that you don't take yourself too seriously all the time.
It's a wrap.
It's a wrap.
It's a wrap.
It's a wrap.
Oh, Copeland. Nedsläpp.
Whether in front of a camera or on the streets, it is obvious that Henrik is comfortable in the limelight, a trait that makes him perfect for not just one of the biggest cities in Sweden, but also for the largest in the United States.
From this beautiful city to one of my favorites, New York City, what is that like for a kid who grew up here to play in a very popular city? Crazy hockey fans, I say that in a nice way. What is that like for you?
It's amazing. You know, I grew up in a really small town up north. I lived here in Gothenburg. I moved here when I was 16. And like you said, second largest city in Sweden, but still very small compared to New York. But it was still a city that kind of prepared me for what was coming. Hockey here is pretty big. Fans love the team, they're excited. They still demand a lot out of you. Similar to New York, but New York is another level. There's more people, more pressure, more things to do, and in the end, it's just a great place to play. And you know, I love Gothenburg, but my home right now is New York, and I love it.
As I followed Henrik Lundqvist around on a day filled with practice on the ice and promotion off it,
it's a wrap.
I got a taste for the work that the native Scandinavian puts in during the offseason in beautiful Gothenburg, Sweden. Now with the heavy lifting done, it was time for the All-Star goalie and I to switch gears.
This is part of downtown, obviously. We're coming into an area called Vasa. And then you have the big University of Gothenburg is straight ahead.
Take it from me, riding in a Maserati is a great way to see this historic city. But that doesn't mean it's the only method Lundqvist uses to enjoy the sights.
When you're here, do you spend a lot of time on a boat?
I do. I love being on the ocean. I don't own a boat here in Sweden because I don't have that much time to be on the ocean, but I have a lot of friends. They love to sail, and sometimes we're on sailboats, sometimes a motorboat. Take you guys on a little boat trip. You know, the West Coast in the summertime, best way to see is by boat.
Okay.
You go to different islands and you stop and you eat. You got it? All right. We're on board.
We set due west for our destination, one island among the over 220,000 that belong to Sweden. After about a half hour, we made landfall.
This is good to recharge your battery.
Absolutely. Well, you don't want to be here for too long.
No, man.
Just a little, just, you know, a weekend or so.
You spent enough time here, you kind of yearned for the people screaming in Madison Square Garden, believe me.
Yeah, it definitely. You re-energize your batteries, and then you come back to New York, and you can just feel the energy. But it's a good mix. We'll see if they're open. Oh, jag tar nog en blåbär och en choklad.
Rån eller bägare?
Rån, tack.
Yeah.
Let me buy you.
I got. No. You take
care of it. You don't have Swedish money.
Huh?
You only have dollars. So let me buy you ice cream. Jättebra. Och så till honom också.
Thank you. Okay. I owe you in New York. I'm gonna have some vanilla.
That
there. Yes.
Perfect.
Vad heter den här ön?
Fotö.
It's called Fotö.
Fotö.
Fotö, ja.
Fotö.
Yeah, it's pretty close.
It's better than my English.
I was over 3,800 miles away from New York City, but with an American favorite in hand, I felt almost at home in this foreign country. And whether it was the ice cream or the water nearby that relaxed me, I became comfortable enough to touch on a personal topic.
Going back to New York this year is a different man because recently married. Does that change? Has that changed you? The guys don't like to admit this. There are certain sex symbols in certain sports, and you're a sex symbol with the New York Rangers, and now you're married. How does that change?
I've been with my wife now for a long time, and it doesn't really change anything. We do a lot of fun things together, and I have a lot of friends in the city that we go out and have, you know, nice dinners, and we go clubbing once in a while, but, I don't think it will change that much. I'm the same guy, and I'm just officially married, but the relationship I have with my wife, Therese, is still the same.
Though no longer one of New York's most eligible bachelors, Henrik still ranks among the city's most recognizable and stylish athletes. Lundqvist is a favorite of the Big Apple's fashion set, but he claims not to get too wrapped up in that scene.
Some guys care more about fashion and clothes and image, and some people don't care at all. And Sean Avery, yeah, he loves fashion. I would say he is more fashion oriented. He knows a lot about clothes and bags and whatever.
I'm gonna ask you a hockey question. Do you ever think, you know, maybe I would rather be something other than a goalie to score?
Oh yeah. I crossed my mind a lot of times.
Usually during the game, right?
Especially when you give up a bad one. You're like, why am I a goalie? You wish you were a forward, or you're sitting on the bench just, you know, trash talking with the boys on the bench and about anything. Instead, I'm a goalie, and just the mental aspect, the pressure you put on yourself and pressure you get from the surroundings, you know, it's you definitely question it sometimes. But also, you know, there's moments, a lot of moments, where you love it.
I can't imagine many things better than living in Manhattan as an all-star goalie for the Rangers. But this little paradise wasn't so bad either. Unfortunately, all good things must come to an end. It was time to go.
This is really a beautiful area.
Yeah, no, it's like we talked about, it's relaxing. And when you're on an island, you can't really go anywhere. So you just have to relax, you have to let it go.
This body of water, is there a name to it?
The Swedish name is Skagerrak.
If we continued on beyond the city, where would that take us?
Well, the water ends. You go all the way into the city, and all the big boats have to stop there. But they did build a canal from Stockholm down all the way down to Gothenburg. But it's only small sailboats or motorboats that can go on that old canal.
This serene journey was a direct contradiction to the environment that Henrik faces on the ice. Most of the time, Lundqvist deals with swarms of opponents and teammates rotating in front of his goal. But there is at least one instance where all those distractions melt away.
What's it like at the Garden when somebody is coming down Crosby? It's you and him. You got everybody in the place jumping. What's it like for you?
Well, you try not to think about what's going on around you. That's number one, which is hard sometimes. You know, people are just so funny in New York, how crazy and involved they are. But number one rule, don't involve anybody except you and the shooter. And then, you know, you just break it down to a point where, what do I need to do? Don't focus on him or anything else. what do I need to do to stop him? So on a breakaway, I practice breakaway so many times, I know what to do. But obviously, skilled guys, they will still beat you, but you have a better chance of making the save if you stick to what you always practice.
When they're coming down the ice, and you can pick one guy, I guess you don't want to say this publicly, but there'd be one guy you don't want to see with the puck. Is there one guy?
Well, I would be pretty nervous to see my brother coming down against me. Every time I played against him, I always wish that he won't get an opportunity to shoot.
Did he ever score on you?
No.
He never did?
Never in a game. We only played against each other, I think, three, maybe four times. And I remember the first time I was really nervous. And after that, I kind of calmed down a little bit. But I know for sure when we played him in September here, I will be a little bit nervous that he's going to score or something.
With our boat ride over and my appetite stoked by seafaring, there was no better way to enjoy my first Swedish sunset than at a waterside restaurant, one of Gothenburg's best and most beautiful.
If you would like to try some Swedish classic, you should try the Swedish Blegram from Kalix.
I'll have that.
I'll try it. Yeah. Since I'm in Sweden, I'll try it.
So we'll start with that. And then I'm going to have the soup.
I'll try the lobster soup too. I'm going with him all the way down. It seems like two passions I've seen today. One everybody would know would be the Rangers and hockey. Your other passion, and almost a love, of the water. Where'd you get that?
Well, actually, my grandpa was the captain. He was, I don't know if it comes from there, but he was actually captain of a big boat going from Gothenburg to New York City, actually, and
wow,
some other big cities around the world. And my dad and my grandma always waved them goodbye. It's probably a few hundred meters down here, but that was back in the day.
Your background, did it lend itself to hockey as a youngster, as 8, 9-year-old?
If I look, my dad, ski instructor, my mom, never really into sports, so me ended up with hockey. Coincidence, I think. You know, in kindergarten, we had a few guys working there, and they played hockey.
Teachers,
yes. So they, you know, when we had a break, we were outside playing. They actually made the sandbox. It was a big sandbox. They made it an ice rink. So when we had breaks up there in kindergarten, we started playing hockey with the teachers. That's how it started.
What was your father's reaction, who was into skiing, when his sons are now playing hockey?
They always been very supportive of everything we've done. They've never been pushing either way or direction. They always loved, you know, just being there as a support, assisted with the tennis. My brother, we played soccer. We did ski a lot, but hockey was always number one, and they were always very supportive.
All the fame and fortune Lundqvist's hockey career has brought him allows Henrik the freedom and capability to pursue business ventures away from the rink. One of his first is a restaurant, Tiny's and the Bar Upstairs, located in downtown Manhattan.
What attracted you to the restaurant business?
A few friends approached me, Avery, a teammate, and then Matt Abramchuk, who's kind of the brain behind it. You know, he has a few places around the city, and I like his places. So when he said he's going to do this, he's going to design it and run it, and, you know, I liked it.
Will you be heavily involved?
Yeah. Well, I told them right away, just so you know where you have me, I won't be here cleaning tables or do dishes. I'll be here with my friends eating and enjoy it and bring friends and probably a lot of Swedes to the place. And then, you know, I love music, so I might play some music there once in a while. Before I went home to Sweden this summer, I played the guitar and had two friends singing on the second floor. It was fun. It was a lot of fun.
So if somebody goes in there, not every night, but if they might catch you playing the guitar. And
they might.
What about your teammates? Can they sing or can they just skate?
I've been asking around. I want to have a few guys to play with and jam with, but so far there's no luck there.
Summarizing Sweden. That's next in the Game 365.
Over my time with Henrik Lundqvist, I witnessed how hard he works during the off-season and got a taste of Sweden. For sure, the country was beautiful, but it was also very different from what I was used to. Can you define in an abbreviated way what Sweden's all about?
Sweden's all about, wow. Well, if I think about Swedes, we definitely live for the summer because we're pretty up far up north now. So during the winter, it's pretty dark and it's a little colder. So the first thing we always talk about is the weather. It's almost funny how much we talk about it because the weather is not very nice, but. Because we live for the summer and you have these 4 or 5 weeks off and people go away or they go out to the islands and they stay in their summer houses or go out with their boats. And because we have a little bit more time off than the Americans, if I compare, like my sister is married to an American guy now. And for him to take 4 weeks off, that's tough. But in Sweden, that's like common. You get 4 weeks off paid and you know, you try to spend it as well as you can where the sun is.
Sweden to Manhattan, New York. If it was Sweden to different cities, say Dallas, which is a nice city and good sports, mean the same? Would it be the same? Would it have the same energy?
I would probably spend more time in Sweden.
I'm sure the nation would be happy to have him. In 2006, Henrik helped Swedish hockey achieve the ultimate accomplishment, an Olympic gold medal.
What was the country's reaction to you guys when you won the Olympics?
I think a lot of people, they felt very proud and it was a big moment for hockey in Sweden. We had a few years where we were struggling a little bit in the Olympics before it. Torino was a tough one for us. We lost early in the quarterfinal and in a very tough way. So that Olympics was very important to Swedish hockey and to a lot of hockey fans here. So, you know, it meant a lot to a lot of people, but especially for us players, it was an amazing experience.
What would mean more, do you think? Or what does mean more? The Olympics? Or the NHL, playing in New York with the Rangers?
Oh. I think looking back, you definitely want to have your gold medal there from the Olympics. It's a big deal. But emotionally, it's bigger to win a championship in Sweden or especially in the NHL because you go through a lot more. It's a long year. You go through a lot with all the guys on the team. The Olympics is 2 weeks. That's it. But when you look back at what you have achieved, the Olympics is big. But emotionally and physically and mentally, to win a championship, and I mean, I've never been close to win the Stanley Cup, but to win the championship here, you go through a lot. And I can only imagine the satisfaction of winning the Stanley Cup and bring it to New York. It would be amazing.
You know, we've mentioned these fans throughout the day. Imagine a Stanley Cup championship, my Lord.
Yeah. No, I mean that's. I'm dreaming about it. I really do. It would be so amazing. And that's kind of what's pushing you. That's why you're working out, you're skating, even though you're tired, and maybe one day you don't feel like it at all. Maybe you walk at the practice facility in New York, and you see a picture of '94 where all the people were out and all the players, and you start thinking about, what it could be like. And then you just keep going.
Growing up here in Sweden, were you aware of the magnitude of Madison Square Garden?
No, I don't think so. And for every year, I love it even more. Then you get attached to it even more. And then the people, the crowd, the fans, the organization, I appreciate what I have and where I'm at right now, mm-hmm. more and more. And you don't want it to end. So I'm 29 now, but time flies.